Well, welcome to Christ the Redeemer. Let us begin our time of worship with this call to worship from Psalm 100. Make a joyful noise to the Lord, all the earth. Serve the Lord with gladness. Come into his presence with singing. Know that the Lord, he is God. It is he who made us, and we are his. We are his people and the sheep of his pasture. Enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. Give thanks to him. Bless his name. For the Lord is good, and his steadfast love endures forever, and his faithfulness to all generations.
Grace and peace.
Our first scripture reading this morning will be found in 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verses 1 through 11. Now, concerning the times and the seasons, brothers, you have no need to have anything written to you, for you yourselves are fully aware that the day of the Lord will come like a thief in the night.
While people are saying there is peace and security, then sudden destruction will come upon them, as labor pains come upon a pregnant woman, and they will not escape. But you are not in darkness, brothers, for that day to surprise you like a thief. For you are all children of light, children of the day. We are not of the night or of the darkness. So then let us not sleep as others do, but let us keep awake and be sober. For those who sleep, sleep at night, and those who get drunk are drunk at night. But since we belong to the day, let us be sober, having put on the breastplate of faith and love, and for a helmet, the hope of salvation. For God has not destined us for wrath, but to obtain salvation through our Lord Jesus Christ, who died for us so that whether we are awake or asleep, we might live with him. Therefore, encourage one another and build one another up, just as you are doing. This is the word of the Lord.
And now's the time for our corporate confession. As the corporate confession comes up on your screen, please take some time to get it on your heart, and then we'll confess together. Now let us confess together. Heavenly Father, in spite of the everlasting love you have shown to us, we still go our own way. We break your laws, we ignore you and your word, and we damage relationships, foremost with you, but also with those around us. We are sorry for our sins and turn away from them. Because of your Son who died for us, forgive us, cleanse us, and change us. By your Holy Spirit, enable us to live for you and to please you more and more. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
My name is Mark McIntyre. I'm one of your elders here at Christ the Redeemer Church. In a minute, I'm going to ask you to join me in prayer. And as we pray, we're in all different places in Spokane, in our homes, and maybe even around the world. We're also most likely praying at different times, but we're all together, gathered before the throne of our great God. Isn't this cool? Let's pray together. Dear Heavenly Father, you are a great and sovereign Lord. You are the almighty creator of heaven and earth. You control the wind and the sea, yet we're able to come into your presence and call you our Father. We're able to speak to you plainly and know that you hear us and you treasure us, your people. We come in gratitude and humility through the sacrifice of Christ, who stepped into creation as God incarnate, who lived a perfect and sinless life, died a cruel death that he didn't deserve, rose to defeat death, and is now sitting with you in heaven. Thank you, Father, for this gospel. Father, as we endure this unexpected time of quarantine and sheltering in place, we find ourselves facing many tasks that seem daunting, whether it be homeschooling, loss of work, extra work with reduced pay, or just lack of in-person fellowship. We ask for humility as we face these things. Please give us the humility of Christ and help us to take advantage of this unique time in our lives. May we please and honor you as we endure. Father, protect us from fear and grant us the faith that we need. Please give wisdom to our leaders in the community, the state, and the nation as they consider best how to reopen the economy while protecting the vulnerable. Father, we come before you as broken people, living in a broken world. There are many hearing my voice this morning that are hurting and desire your healing hand in their situations. For those who are in need of employment, we ask for your provision of a job. For those who are sick, we ask for health. For those who feel the pain of strained and broken relationships, we ask for peace and for reconciliation. Specifically, I ask for continued healing for Gary Robinson as he battles pneumonia. I ask for relief from terrible back pain for Tammy Holdren. I give you praise and thanksgiving for providing needed repairs for the Castillo's roof this week. Father, I lift up to you Jeff Tangway as he serves medically in a coronavirus hotspot in New Orleans. Please protect him from this virus, give him words of encouragement for his very sick patients, and give him endurance for long physically and emotionally exhausting days. We lift up to you South Hill Bible Church and Pastor John Underhill. We thank you for the faithful proclamation of the gospel that they have in our community and ask that they be strengthened by your word. Give them wisdom as they minister in this unique time. Father, please empower Cary and speak through him. Give us ears to hear your word and hearts to be molded by it. These things we ask in the name of your Son, our Redeemer, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Well, we are now back in to the book of Revelation, and we're straight into one of the most controversial and terrifying sections in the book, the seven bowls of God's wrath, here in chapter 15. If you're not there, chapter 15 of Revelation. Verse 5 is where we're starting. Now, the wrath of God is not something that people generally like to talk about or even think about, and rightfully so. It's pretty awful and terrifying. It's not something that I really even like to preach about. Believe me, I'd much rather preach on faith or hope or love. Those subjects are a lot more fun, and you can usually work in a puppy illustration into those sermons. But you can't do that with a sermon on wrath. There's really no room. And for some people, God's wrath is not even something that they will acknowledge. They say when it comes to the subject of wrath, hey, that's just not how I like to think about God. That's not the God that I believe in. He's a loving God. Or my favorite one, hey, I think that's more of the God of the Old Testament. I'm into the God of the New Testament and Jesus. So they kind of reshape God by their own image, from their own imaginations, and leave out any idea of judgment or wrath, making their minds and their views kind of sovereign over Scripture. Well, let me just say, God's wrath is everywhere in the Bible. Old Testament, New Testament, the Gospels, in the epistles, it's in the very words of Jesus, it's in the book of Genesis at the beginning, and it's in this final book of the Bible, Revelation, because it's crucial for us to understand. It's not pleasant or fun, but it's very important for us to consider and think about and get a hold of the wrath of God. Because without understanding the wrath of God, we can't understand the world we live in. Let me say that again. If you don't understand the wrath of God, you will not be able to understand this world that we live in. If you want to understand our environment, then you need to understand the wrath of God. If you're confused by the personal suffering and evil in this world, then you need to understand the wrath of God. If you want to understand the trajectory of history, what's happening, where it's going on, where it's going, then you need to understand the wrath of God, which is what we're going to try to do today as we consider this in chapters 15 and 16, and hopefully we'll get somewhere. Now, I've divided this text into three main sections. 3 points. So that would be chapter 15, verses 5 to 8 is the origin of God's wrath. And chapter 16, verses 1 to 12 is the dispensing of God's wrath. And chapter 16, verses 13 to 21 is the culmination of God's wrath. So let's start just with the origin of God's wrath in these first five verses, or 5 to 8 in chapter 15. Let's read them. It says, "After this I looked, and the sanctuary of the tent of witness in heaven was opened. And out of the sanctuary came the seven angels with the seven plagues, clothed in pure, bright linen, with golden sashes around their chests. And one of the four living creatures gave to the seven angels seven golden bowls full of the wrath of God who lives forever and ever. And the sanctuary was filled with smoke from the glory of God and from his power. And no one can enter the sanctuary until the seven plagues of the seven angels were finished." So here is the setting for these seven bowls of wrath to be poured out. It originates, it starts in heaven. In fact, it says it comes from the sanctuary of the tent of witness in heaven. It's a pretty interesting and very specific image from the Old Testament. John in this book has talked about heaven. He's talked about the temple in heaven and the glory in heaven and the throne in heaven. But this is the first time he uses this image of the tent of witness in heaven. Now, there's two things we need to understand about the tent of witness, that image out of the Old Testament. First of all, it is the place where the very law of God, as written on the stone tablets, the Ten Commandments, actually resided. They kept it in the tent of witness. That's why it was called the tent of witness. It testified to the demands of our perfect moral God, his moral law. And remember, the law isn't God's just random, arbitrary moral standards that he decided to impose on us. These are expositions of the way God created us. These are what's the things that are written on our hearts, that right and wrong that we know down deep, that's part of us. These are the laws that when we violate them, we do damage to ourselves and we do damage to this world. We go against how we were created. This is where the wrath of God is brought forth from the very law chamber of God. But the second thing you need to realize about the tent of witness is that it is the place where the very holy presence of God resided. It was also called the tent of meetings. It's where they could meet the very holy presence of God. It was a pillar of, he would look at it as a pillar of fire by night resting on the tent, a pillar of cloud by day resting on that tent. And his glory filled the whole thing. Only the priests could go into the inner sanctuary. I think this is why John describes the angels that come out with the bowl of wrath. What does he say in verse 6? He describes them as being in bright linen and golden sashes. See, they're radiating the priestly holiness of God and his purity. So to put these images together, the origin, the basis of God's wrath is his perfect, gracious law and his essential holiness. See, this means something about the nature of the wrath of God, doesn't it? His angry judgment, right? It means that it's not anything like our anger, my anger, your anger. It's not a loss of temper over some random thing that's irritated him and hindered his selfish pursuit, so he just kind of explodes and loses it, you know, like when I can't find the remote control because the kids have lost it again. Or I'm walking through the yard and I see one of my favorite tools just rusting there in the grass because somebody left it there and I want to lose my brain, or maybe I do. That's not the kind of wrath we're talking about. To paraphrase Leon Morris, he says, God's wrath is his strong, settled opposition to all that is wrong and destroying us and evil. It arises out of his holy nature and causes this burning zeal for all that is right and good, and thus he must act upon evil to destroy it. Or to put it simply, his wrath is his autonomic, that reflexive response to his holiness. His wrath is the autonomic response of his holiness. His holiness will react to evil. Of course it will. His righteousness will go against all that is wrong. His purity will repel perversion. His love will not be indifferent to hate and sin. It will act. People love to say, how could a loving, holy God ever react in wrath? Answer, how could he not? If he's truly loving and pure and holy and just and righteousness, it will be his reflexive response. The wrath that we see these angels bring in these seven bowls originates from the very law room of God's holy sanctuary, and it is pure and it is right without any trace of earthly anger or hatred in it. It is good. We must understand this. We must contemplate this deeply if we're ever going to be able to engage in a real way with the wrath of God in this world and in our lives. Now, the second thing that we need to look at in this text is the dispensing of God's wrath. We've seen its origin, but let's look at how it's dispensed. And we see this in chapter 16, verses 1 through 12, mostly in the first six bowls being poured out. And I want to read through a few of them so we get a feel. So start at verse 1 with me of chapter 16. Then I heard a loud voice from the temple telling the seven angels, go and pour out on the earth the seven bowls of the wrath of God. So the first angel went and poured out his bowl on the earth, and harmful and painful sores came upon the people who bore the mark of the beast and worshipped its image. The second angel poured out his bowl into the sea, and it became like a blood of a corpse, and every living thing died that was in the sea. The third angel poured out his bowl into the rivers and the springs of water, and they became blood. You see, what we need to notice right away about the dispensing of God's wrath here is that it's environmental and ecological, isn't it? The first bowl is poured out on the earth, and it causes disease. The second and third are poured out on the sea and the river, blood polluting and causing death to all the living creatures. The fourth actually affects the sun. The sun being allowed to overheat and scorch the earth. It's sort of the ultimate global warming. And as if you read on in these, you'll see there's darkness that goes across the land. You'll see there's lightning and earthquakes and hailstorms. God's judgment on those in rebellion against him, those carrying the mark of the beast, right? That mark on their forehead, their minds, and on their hand, their actions, those living for the beast in rebellion against God, God's judgment on them is meted out in this environmental and kind of ecological way. Now, it's an interesting idea, isn't it, if you stop and think about it, but it's really not that new. First of all, you might have noted that there's a strong allusion here to the Exodus judgments on Pharaoh. It's pretty unmistakable, right? Sores, rivers turning to blood, darkness over the land, hailstorms. You can't miss it. And God, in that Old Testament story, is acting in his wrath against a kingdom set against him that is persecuting and oppressing his people. And to save them, what does he do? He brings environmental disaster on their enemies. He uses the blessings of creation, even that final wave that wipes them out, the blessings of creation as a curse. Which, of course, if you think about it, brings us back to Genesis 3, where in response to mankind's sin in the garden, where God had made it all perfect and beautiful for them, what does God do in response to their rebellion and sin? He curses the ground of this earth. He makes the environment hard and toilsome and a struggle until we return to the dust. This is how he dispenses his wrath, his just punishment in and on this world. Our environment is his instrument. And if you're not that sure about this, let me read a couple verses for you from Isaiah. First of all, Isaiah 26:9. I read it once before, but in the middle of it, it says this: "For when your judgments are in the earth, the inhabitants of the world learn righteousness." Your judgments in, not on, but in the earth. You flip a little farther in Isaiah to Isaiah 45, verse 7. It says this: "I form light and create darkness. I make well-being and create calamity." As sure as God makes the light and the dark, he makes well-being and he brings calamity, disaster. You move into the New Testament, you move to Romans chapter 8, verse 19. "For the creation waits with eager longing for the revealing of the sons of God. For the creation was subjected to futility, not willingly, but because of him who subjected it." Who subjected creation to futility? God did. You see, this should make us rethink the term natural disaster. It's not just something that's kind of just nature-driven, is it? This should really make us rethink maybe this pandemic. God's wrath, his righteous anger and judgment, gives us understanding of the world around us. What's going on today is not random, senseless, useless outworkings of a chaotic, evolutionary world. Much of it is part of God's wrathful, just work. We can listen to the media and the scientists and the pundits all day long, but we don't really get what's going on until we embrace what God's word says about the outworkings of his wrath. That's when we begin to have understanding. Now, don't get me wrong. I am not saying that a village that is wiped out by a tsunami or an individual that dies of COVID-19, that they are more guilty in some way and specifically targeted in another way by God's wrath. No, even Christians die in tsunamis and from COVID-19, although their eternity is secure. No, such calamity and disaster is that generalized outflow of God's wrath upon this world. Not just him letting the consequences of our sin take place, but him working those consequences. And remember, he brings this for two reasons, this kind of wrath to his world. First of all, it's a warning. We saw that already when we looked at the seven trumpets of judgment. They were called trumpets because they're trumpet blasts of warnings, warning people to see what's going on, to see that this world is messed up and wrong, to see that they aren't right, and to repent before it's too late. But his wrath, we see here, is also a straight out just punishment on evil, at least in its final form, isn't it? Did you notice the little speech from the third angel in verse 5. I love this part of the text. Right in the middle, the third angel pours out their bowl of wrath, and then the angel says, verse 5, "And I heard the angel in charge of the waters say, 'Just are you, O Holy One, who is and who was, for you brought these judgments. For they have shed the blood of the saints and the prophets, and you have given them blood to drink. It is what they deserve.' And I heard the altar saying," the altar obviously has to pipe in as well, "'And I heard the altar saying, 'Yes, Lord God, the Almighty, true and just are your judgments.'" God in his wrath is not capricious or arbitrary. We see here that they get what they deserve. That's what it says in verse 6. And in fact, literally, it says, they are worthy of this judgment. They've earned it. It's their due. J.I. Packer says, of the ultimate judgment of God, "Nobody stands under the wrath of God save those who have chosen to do so. They have chosen as they have rejected him, their creator. They have chosen as they have rejected his prophets who have repeatedly brought them his truth and warnings. They have chosen as they have rejected his son who he sent to save them with his very life. They have chosen as they have continued to reject and persecute his people who proclaim his salvation." My pastor in Australia, Philip Jensen, says there'll be nobody in hell saying, "I'm so sorry, I didn't know." No, what people in hell do is they just keep on sinning and keep on rejecting and hating God because that's what they've chosen. And note the continuation of the choosing in this text. Of these people right in this text. Look at verse 9 with me. As the bowl of wrath comes down upon them, how does the verse end? "They did not repent and give him glory." The next bowl of wrath comes down upon them, verse 11, "And they cursed the God of heaven for their pain and sores, and they did not repent of their deeds." The wrath of God in the end is the deserved punishment of a holy, patient God who is calling for repentance. And that brings me to the second thing to observe about this dispensing of his judgment and his wrath. Not only is it kind of environmental and ecological throughout this world, but it is progressive. You probably noticed right away that the seven bowls of wrath here are a lot like the seven trumpets of wrath in chapter 8 and a lot like the seven seals of judgment in chapter 6. And that's because they're not new judgments, right? It's not 7, 7, and 7 adding up to 21 judgments that we line up to try to, you know, make an almanac of the judgments in the end times. No, it's God replaying the same ways, the same patterns of his judgments in history. He uses wars and diseases and famines. He did this with Pharaoh. He did this and the Egyptians. He did this in the early church days. He's still doing this even today and even more so since the cross. But what I want us to notice is that in this pattern of judgment, this process of him dispensing his wrath, there is a progression. Although it's showing us the same things, there's a progression of the scope of the wrath each time it's displayed. In the seven seals of wrath, they covered a fourth of the earth, if you look back at it, so that the rest of the people could see them and respond in repentance. In the seven trumpets of judgment, they cover a third, a larger portion of the earth, so the people left could be warned. So each time God was mitigating the judgment, holding it back in his mercy, but each time the scale gets larger, And now, as we have the seven bowls of wrath, note there is no mitigation. There is no fractional mercy. God's wrath is poured out on the earth in full. In fact, look at the bookends of this text. If you go to chapter 15, verse 1, that starts this whole section, it says this: "Then I saw another sign in heaven, great and amazing, seven angels with seven plagues, which are the last, for with them the wrath of God is finished." And then flip to chapter 16, verse 17. As we get to the seventh bowl, "The seventh angel poured out his bowl into the air, and a loud voice came out of the temple from the throne, saying, 'It is done.'" It's finished. My friends, this is what we need to understand about the historic evolution of our world. This is where history is heading. To a final, no more mitigation, no more mercy, ultimate judgment, where it is all done. The secular humanist and even the religious optimist often deny this reality. They look to the upward trajectory of science with its exploration and wonderful new discoveries and the constant advancement of technologies from the Industrial Revolution to the computer age to genetic engineering. And they sort of project out of this a positive moral evolution so that over time the world is becoming more ethically enlightened and safer and purer. The only problem with this theory is reality. History, ancient, modern, present, says otherwise, doesn't it? Advancements in science and technology on the morality spectrum have only served to make us more skilled and efficient sinners. Just think about how the internet has been used, or how nuclear tech is used, or how genetic stuff is being used today. C.S. Lewis, in his essay, "The World's Last Night," said this: "The idea of the world slowly ripening to perfection is a myth, not a generalization from experience." You can't know it from experience. See, if we want to correctly interpret our world so that we live rightly in it, we need to let go of the media in this hand, and we need to let go of science in the other hand, and we need to grab hold of our Bibles with both hands and believe it. The world is progressing morally downward, and the wrath of God will continue to expand upon us until his final cataclysmic judgment. And that brings me to my final point about wrath here, and that is the culmination of God's wrath. We moved from the origin to the dispensing to the culmination of his wrath. You see, we get this little interlude just before the seventh and final bowl of wrath, and it tells us about this great final battle with some very crazy yet not unfamiliar symbolic language. Verse 13, let's read. "And I saw coming out of the mouth of the dragon, and out of the mouth of the beast, and out of the mouth of the false prophet, three unclean spirits like frogs, for they are demonic spirits performing signs, who go abroad to the kings of the whole world to assemble them for battle on the great day of God the Almighty." Skip to verse 16. "And they assembled them at the place that in Hebrew is called Armageddon." So here we have this kind of unholy trinity of characters. You have the dragon representing Satan, as we know from earlier texts. You have the beast, probably the beast of the sea from chapter 13, who represents the kind of the political and governmental powers of this world. You have the false prophet, again from chapter 13, representing the false religions of this world. And they come together in unity, and out of their mouths come these unclean, frog-like, demonic spirits that go out around the globe and woo in the kings and the leaders of the world to assemble them for a great battle against God and his people. Really, it's kind of the ultimate fulfillment of Psalm 2, isn't it? Where he talks about the nations raging against God and his anointed. Throughout history, this has been the case, hasn't it? Whether it's the Roman Empire or Islamic nations or secular media or godless government or false religion or false teachers in the church. But here there is this unprecedented demonic unity as God seems to let loose his restraints on Satan's capacity. I think that's what verse 6 is about, that bowl where it dries up the Euphrates so that the enemies can cross over. He's let loose the capacity of Satan. And the nations and the powers come, they come together as one to defy God and to persecute and destroy his people in a final battle. The battle that we all know as the Battle of Armageddon. And let me say two things about that. We have no idea where Armageddon is going to happen. Armageddon means Mount Megiddo. There is no Mount Megiddo. There is a Plains of Megiddo. I've been there. There's a McDonald's near it. And I think it's strategically placed for some end times business. But we really don't know. There's thousands of pages. It could be just symbolic. Mount Megiddo, him painting this dramatic image. The point is, though, it's a real event that's going to happen. The Satan using his lies to bring the powers of this world to stand against God and his people in a final way. But here's the second thing you need to realize about it. It's not much of a battle. Verse 17, then the seventh angel poured out his bowl into the air, and a loud voice came out of the temple from the throne saying, "It is done." And in fact, when you go to chapter 19 and you see this scene, Armageddon, when Jesus shows up, what happens? Big cosmic struggle? No, he shows up and it's over. It's done. He brings his judgment. So what are we to make of all this? What are we to take home from this as we understand more the origin and the dispensing and the culmination of God's wrath in this world? Well, first of all, I think we need to be encouraged by this. You know, this was written initially to a church that was experiencing all kinds of persecution and tribulation. It was written to help them endure. God wants them and us to see that real and ultimate just judgment is coming. Nobody gets away from it. There will be vindication for their martyred brothers and sisters, whether that's today or back then. There will be vindication. Evil will be put down for good. When they cried out, "How long, O Lord?" He's telling them, it's coming. He'll bring judgment. He'll save his people, just like he did out of Egypt. And that's encouraging news. We need to remember that as we kind of look around our world that seems so dominated by evil and rebellion, where things seem just to go unpunished. Judgment is coming. Just judgment. Second thing, we need to be ready. The most obvious application that you can't miss in this text is verse 15. In my Bible, it's actually in red because it's Jesus interjecting his voice into the scene with a word of advice. Look at it. He says, right in the middle of it, Jesus speaks into it and says, "Behold, I am coming like a thief. Blessed is the one who stays awake, keeping his garments on, that they may not go about naked and be seen exposed." This is about spiritual vigilance, isn't it? Being ready, being aware that there is a spiritual battle going on and it's progressing every day and God is bringing in his judgment. He's saying, don't be caught off guard. Don't be complacent. Don't be caught with your pants down in the middle of the battle because you've fallen asleep. It makes me think of the church at Sardis, right? Where he says, wake up. I'm coming like a thief. Don't be asleep. And you know what I think is the most practical thing we can do when it comes to spiritual vigilance? It's pray. Jesus says to his disciples in the garden, when they're supposed to be on guard, what does he say? Watch and pray as they're falling asleep. Watch and pray. In Ephesians, when the soldier is pictured on as putting on all the armor of God in chapter 6, at the end, what does he do? Go out in battle? No. Says he prays. This is something I've been really encouraged about lately with our church. One of the great things that I think the environment of this pandemic has brought about. At our last Zoom prayer meeting, there were 28 people there. I don't know if you've ever been, you know that's a record by far. Moms, dads, missionaries, young people, old. God is using this pandemic to open our eyes to the reality of this decaying world, that it's not right, that it's under judgment, and we are starting to pray. You should come join us. You really have no excuse, right? You don't have to dress up. We don't even have to see you. You can just have your name across the screen. You could be in your bed for all we know. You can even put Hawaii behind you on this so that you can be there and pray with us. Or just listen to us pray. 7:30 on Wednesday. Join with us. Be spiritually vigilant. Pray. Finally, I want to say, besides being encouraged and besides being ready, we need to be repentant. You see, I think when John penned the words of verse 17 here, describing this angel of heaven as he poured out the last bowl of wrath, crying out, "It's done! It is finished!" I think he heard the echo of the words he penned in his gospel. The words of Jesus on the cross crying out, "It is finished." And I think he expects us to hear the echo. This moment goes all the way back to the cross where Jesus had the wrath of God poured out on him, where he took it in fully. He took our judgment and he finished it for us so that nobody has to face this future day of wrath. It's a choice. Repent and be saved. You see, the God who will send these seven angels with his final wrath to this world is the same God who so loved this world that he sent his only Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish in judgment, but have eternal life. There is no refuge from the wrath of God in this world, but there is refuge in him. Repent. Let's pray. Father, we pray that you will help us to understand your holiness and your goodness, your law that your wrath comes out of. That you'll help us to see how you are working it in this world to see through all the lies, and that you will help us to be ready for the full culmination to come. Make us people who live rightly in light of your wrath to come, and who live in hope because of your Son. Amen.
Let's sing together. Let us love and sing and wonder.
Receive the benediction from 1 Thessalonians 5. For God has not destined us for wrath, but to obtain salvation through our Lord Jesus Christ, who died for us so that whether we are awake or asleep, we might live with him. Therefore, encourage one another and build one another up, just as you are doing. Amen.